Welcome to the Way Church Service at Greystone with Pastor John. We invite you to join us at 1 Oakleigh Avenue in North Providence, Rhode Island. This podcast is presented to you by the Way Ministries, supported by listeners like you. For donations, live videos, podcasts, and more, please visit www.thewayministriesri.org. Thank you and have a great day.
Welcome to the Way Service at Greystone. I'd like to thank everyone for coming off this morning to get a portion of God's Word. And first and foremost, I'd like to thank our risen Savior, the Lord Jesus, this morning for making all this possible for us by going to the cross, shedding His blood for the forgiveness of our sins, becoming obedient to death, and becoming the final sacrifice for our sins so we could have a new life. Eternal life, spiritual life, and a new purpose here on planet Earth for all who believe in the one and only Son of God. We gather here to learn about our Creator and find our purpose here and use it to glorify God and to serve our Lord and Savior, Jesus, and one another. Our goal, this ministry has a goal, and that is to grow spiritually and start to handle life God's way, not our way. God's Word, which is the Bible, becomes the owner's manual to our lives. And we study it, learn it, read it, and apply it to see how God wants us to live, how to think, how to act, how to serve, and how to treat ourselves and others. Thank you, Jesus. Each part of His body is very precious to God. One body?
Many parts.
Many parts. I want to welcome you all to the Way. We depend on God's grace, not our own power, to accomplish His will for our lives. I'd like to shout out to our family on the live feed who can't be here with us this morning. If you'd like to worship with us and unity the Spirit together this morning, you are welcome to. And if you consider this your church, if you would consider supporting it so we can get the message way beyond the four walls and help restore her to her former glory. And if you have a cell phone, can you please silence it so it doesn't disturb this morning's service? And as always, we will start with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Jesus, thank You for today, Lord. Thank You for the gift of life, Lord. Thank You for the gift of salvation, Father. Thank You for Your generous provisions that You provide for us each and every day, Lord. Let us never lose sight of that, Lord. Thank You for the final sacrifice You made for us, Lord, to set us free from the power, the penalty, and the presence of sin, Father. We're so eternally grateful for You, Jesus. We'd like to say a special prayer to our family that are suffering or sickness. Our sister Susan for her cancer. Mary, Donna's sister, for her cancer. Larry for his continued recovery. Chris for his continued recovery. Susan, another one with breast cancer, was the organ player here. Alana, our brother George's recovery. Jean for cancer. And we got Colin that's in rehab right now. And then we're going to say a special prayer for Howie too as he struggles with his flesh. And as always, anyone else that might be struggling or suffering or sick, that You reassure them You'll never leave them nor forsake them, that You're with them always, Lord, and You're always going to be there for them, Lord. And there's a purpose in everything You do. I pray for our great country, Lord, America, Lord, that You keep Your hands upon it, Lord. Please, Lord, bring unity back to the churches and tear down all denominational ties, Lord. Put the Bible right back in the pulpit as our owner's manual. And I always ask that You put the Bible back in the White House, Lord, so we can make our country great again based on the biblical principles for which it was founded, Lord. We pray for the nation Israel, that they accept Jesus as the Messiah so we can restore peace to that nation. And as always, let all this be led by Your Spirit this morning, Father, and not my flesh. And it's in Jesus' powerful name that I pray. Amen and amen. All right, we're going to stand and worship the Lord.
We
Love that song. Sit down and be set free. Amen. Come to the table. What a great job she did singing, right? What a great church. What a beautiful day. Have a round of applause. One body, many parts. Awesome, awesome. All right, we are going to be celebrating the Lord's Supper this morning. So I ask that you prepare your hearts and your minds to receive the Eucharist and prepare your hearts to receive the message that the Spirit is trying to say to the church this morning. Amen? All right, so we're going to watch a short video clip and get started. Amen to that. We're all overcomers. We believe in Jesus, we overcome. And overcoming is not a feeling, it's a fact. As we watch the visual, we already have all this power. I'm going to talk about this morning, about the supernatural power that we have through the Lord's Supper. We already have it, but this just reminds us when we take this in, that we really have this kind of power. Can I get an amen? We have resurrection power in each and every one of us. And this just reassures us as a tangible evidence that we possess that. And we take the elements in. We're taking in the benefit and the meaning of what Jesus did for us. The death, burial, and resurrection of him gives us a resurrection of a new life and a new birth of spiritual life. Amen? All right. The Lord's Supper is a wonderful gift from God. Okay? And is a seal of God's promises to all who have come to Christ in repentance and in faith. The more you grasp the meaning and significance of the Lord's Supper, the more you will benefit from it. You can enter more fully into the Lord's Supper. At the Lord's table, Christ calls us to look back and remember his sacrifice for us on the cross by partaking of the bread and the wine. This is not a complicated message, okay? I want to encourage his people with the good news of God's unconditional love and to see that reality change our thinking in our life. I want to encourage you to expect God's power to show up when you receive Holy Communion. This message will give us the confidence we need to receive God's supernatural power when we simply put our faith in the precious body and blood of Jesus. Can I get an amen here? I believe it will transform our life. How? First, Jesus instituted communion or the Lord's Supper for you and for me. When he was at the table with them, he took the bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to them in Luke 24:30. We just saw the account. When we take communion, we are receiving his life, the very life of Christ. This is not some ritual. His life is love. We are partaking of his love. His life is healing. We are partaking of his healing. His life is mercy and grace. And we are partaking of his mercy and his grace. His life flows with blessing in communion. We are partaking of his blessings. Every time we take communion, we activate the life and power of Jesus, allowing his life to flow through us. And this is a key lesson to take to heart. Christianity is not us living for Jesus. It is actually Jesus living through us. Go with me to Romans chapter 12, please. There is a blue card in the pew if you have a hard time finding the scriptures that'll help you get to it if you need help. Well, we'll be going through the scriptures this morning. In Romans 12, it tells us how to behave. It shows us. In Romans 12 is moving from the theological to the practical. Paul gives guidelines for living as a redeemed people in a fallen world. We are to give ourselves to Christ as living sacrifices, obey the government, love our neighbors, and take special care of those who are weak in the faith. He closes with personal remarks. Through this section, we learn how to live our faith each day. Personal responsibility, a living sacrifice to God. Verse 1. Is everybody there? Okay. Everybody with me so far? All right. And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all he has done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind he will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him. Can I get an amen? Amen. Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by hocus pocus. No, by changing the way you think. How we transform? By changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. Get what he's saying here? How do we get transformed? By renewing our minds through the Word of God, the living, holy Word of God. All too often, if you're not intentional, communion can become just a ritual. But there is so much power in it. I want us to experience the power that comes through the body and blood of Jesus Christ today. Remembering Jesus through communion brings breakthrough. He said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me," as it tells us in 1 Corinthians 11, 24 to 25. Notice, now, breakthrough power is not found in remembering our sins. It is not found in remembering our past or our pain. It is found in remembering Jesus, the living Word of God. Remembering what he did on the cross. Remembering his love, his healing, his grace, and his mercy. Whatever you've done and whatever has been done to you, God has already outdone it, overcome it, and paid the price for it through the finished work of the cross. It's time we plug into the power of God in our lives, activate the power of God that's inside us. What did we do when we proclaimed Jesus as Savior and Lord? We plugged into the power of his salvation when we confessed with our mouth that Jesus is Lord and believed in our heart that God raised him from the dead. We activated the power of salvation the moment we declared Jesus is Lord. Can I get a big amen here? In the same way, when we partake of the communion, remembering him, we are activating God's power in our present moment or situation. I want to encourage us today. These are difficult days. There have been many times when I've taken communion in the midst of fear and confusion. Times when I wasn't sure what I was supposed to do, when things all around me were very unsettled. In those moments, at the table, remembering Jesus, communion with his body and his blood and his people, a peace came over me that passes all understanding. His healing came. His freedom came. The supernatural presence of Jesus in his body and blood is enough to silence all the accusing voices that condemn, limit, and defeat us. Jesus is inviting us to come to the table. You hear the song, right? That's our song. Come to the table and find healing and rest for our souls in and through him. Let us come to his table expecting peace to flow like a river, expecting the joy and the happiness of God to flow in your life like a river, and expecting power from heaven to show up in your life. Whenever we take communion, let us take it simply by putting our faith in the precious body and blood of Jesus Christ. Ask him for whatever you need, believe for his supernatural power to show up, and expect to receive it. You'll be so glad that you did. Go with me to Philippians 4. We have so much power as Christians that we don't harness and use today to show light in this dark world right now. We have the light of the world living inside of us. We have to understand this. And by saying no to the flesh and yes to the spirit, especially in these dark days, shows that there's a better way. The way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through Jesus. Look at Philippians 4, look at verse 4. Always be full of joy in the Lord. I say it again, rejoice. Look at verse 5. Let everyone see that you are considerate in all you do. Remember, the Lord is coming soon. That's a big amen there. I believe he is. He is coming soon. Now it tells us in verse 6, all you worry warts out there, don't worry about anything. Instead, let's replace it with praying about everything. Can I get an amen here? It's called removal and replacing. You have to remove the worry and replace it with prayer. You see, we don't just remove the worry. It has to be replaced or the worry comes back. Get it? It says, don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Now, look what it says. Tell God what you need. He wants to talk to you. And thank him for all that he has done. And he has done a lot. Then you will experience. See, it's not just words. You'll experience God's peace in your life, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your heart and your mind as you live in Christ Jesus. When it says as you live in Christ Jesus, it says as you live by the very word of God. From Genesis to Revelation, that's what renews us, that's what transforms us. The written word becomes the living word. When the Holy Spirit comes into the believer, that word now is alive. Every word in the Bible is alive and powerful. It cuts through the soul and the flesh, the bone and the marrow and the spirit. It reveals everything. And it shows us how to live right and do the right thing. It is our owner's manual. Can I get an amen? When it says Jesus, Jesus is the word. So how do we benefit from the Lord's Supper? Let's just go now. The bread, right? The bread speaks of Christ's body in which he lived the perfect human life. Jesus lived a life that none of us could ever achieve. He never spoke a sinful word or had a sinful thought. He always obeyed the Father's will. He always loved, he always hoped, always believed. The body of Jesus speaks of his perfect life that was given for us. He laid down that life of perfect obedience so that we who are so far from the righteousness of God may find in him what we do not have in ourselves. How about a big amen there? Amen. When we come to the Lord's table, we often feel unworthy. But God reminds us in the picture of the bread that our salvation does not rest on the progress of the work of the Holy Spirit in us, but on the completion of the work of Christ for us on the cross. Can I get an amen? It's on the finished work. None of us have ever offered God perfect obedience and never will. But when we take the bread, we are reminded that God counts his perfect obedience as if it was our own. He gives us his righteousness. Thank you, Jesus. Now the cup or the wine. The wine speaks about the blood of Jesus poured out. Blood in the veins speaks of life. But the blood separated from the body speaks of death. Can I get an amen here? Okay. The bread speaks of our Lord's obedience. The wine speaks of his sacrifice. having no sin of his own, Jesus chose to bear ours. He became our sacrifice, absorbing the judgment of God. And through the shedding of his blood, he released forgiveness for us. God wants to seal what Christ has done for us into our minds and into our hearts. So he tells us to partake of the bread and the wine in remembrance of him, to seal that. When reflecting on the Lord's, on the Last Supper, through participation in communion, we can deepen our relationship with God and become more like Jesus. By regularly reflecting on Jesus' sacrifice and committing to following him, we can become more faithful, loving individuals who seek to serve others. To seek to serve others. Until that day, we look back, we look in, we look up, look around, and look forward. We draw strength from our Savior as we partake of the cup and the bread. Communion rooted in the Last Supper is a timeless tradition that transcends the boundaries of time and space. It serves as a bridge between the earthly and the divine, a tangible reminder of Christ's sacrifice and the covenant that binds believers to God. In this sacred event, we find not only a connection to our spiritual heritage, but also a profound encounter with the living Christ, who invites us to remember, reflect, and renew our commitment to a faith built on love and sacrifice. Can I get an amen, believers? Communion is not a mere ritual. It is a living memory etched in our hearts as believers in Christ. It serves as a spiritual anchor, connecting us to the foundational moments of our faith. Each time you or I partake in the breaking of the bread and the sharing of the cup, we participate in a timeless act of remembrance. The event transcends the physical plane, inviting individuals to reflect on the profound implication of Christ's sacrifice for each and every one of our lives. So who's invited to this feast this morning? Who is to receive the Lord's Supper? All who believe that Jesus, as their Lord and Savior, who died on the cross, that they may be forgiven of their sins and reconciled to God and rose from the dead. All right, let's pray for this communion. Prayer for the bread. Lord, as we take this bread, we remember that you are the bread of life. You feed our souls. You nourish our hearts. And you give us sustenance to run the race before us. As we break the bread, we feel the softness of your love for us. We smell the fragrance of the grace you release afresh every day. We thank you with all our hearts for the great price you paid when you were crucified on the cross for us. Yet, just as the yeast has caused the bread to rise, you rose again, triumphant over death, as Lord of lords and kings of kings forever. And our beloved Savior, Lord, as we drink this cup, we remember that you are the giver of life. You are forgiveness. You bring deep peace to our souls, and your love flows within us. As we pour out this cup, we see your sacrifice poured out for us. We notice the depth of your goodness and the pain you suffered for us. We dwell upon the intricacy of human life and the price you paid to set humanity free. Yet just as the tombstone rolled away to unleash the risen Lord, your light shines in our hearts right now, extinguishing all darkness to release heaven's blessings upon us. Thank you. In the Lord Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. We take communion to remember the night in which Jesus was betrayed. He broke the bread and gave thanks. We remember communion and the events that led to Jesus' crucifixion, death, and resurrection. And at this time, I'm going to call the ushers up to pass out the elements. Thank you, gentlemen. All right, we're going to, if you want to follow with me, in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23. For I pass on to you what I received from the Lord himself. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took some bread and gave thanks to God for it. Then he broke it in pieces and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me, in remembrance of the Lord's broken body. Let us eat the bread. In verse 25, in the same way, he took the cup of wine after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood. Do this in remembrance of me as often as you drink it. For every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are announcing the Lord's death until he comes again." In remembrance of the Lord's death and the shedding of his blood, let us drink the cup. All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we praise you for this heavenly banquet that you have so freely given to us. Thank you that we carry in our hearts the riches of this eternal goodness. May we pour it out wherever we go, Father, lighting up the darkness with truth, speaking out hope where there is despair, and weaving your unconditional love into all that we do. Send us now in the power and strength of the Holy Spirit. May we live to be all that you have destined us to be. Dear Lord Jesus, thanks and praise to you. Again, you fed us at your holy table with your own body and blood. By your word and supper, may we be led from this world of sorrow into life eternal. In the name of our risen Savior, the Lord Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen. How about a round of applause for Jesus? All right. Woo. I'm energized now. Thank you, Jesus. Wow. It's so important to remember that. Because without that, we wouldn't even have a church. Without that event. It has to be recognized. Brings us right back to our faith, the roots. All right. Let us turn to Joshua chapter 1. I'm going to start there this morning. As we only have a little bit of time here, but I'm going to go keep as long as I have to. Lock the door, Paul. Nobody's getting out of here. All right. She got us in verse 6, but we're going to go to verse 1 because it's very important we understand the connection here. Because, you know, after wandering for 40 years in the wilderness, a new generation is ready to enter Canaan here. But first God prepares Joshua and the nation by teaching them the importance of courageous and consistent faith. The nation then miraculously crosses the Jordan River to begin the long-awaited conquest of the promised land. Like Joshua, we too need faith to begin and grow in the Christian life. Joshua leads the nation, verse 1. After the death of Moses, the Lord's servant, the Lord spoke to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' assistant. He said, "Moses, my servant, is dead. Therefore, the time has come for you to lead these people, the Israelites, across the Jordan River into the land I am giving them. I promise you what I promised Moses. Wherever you set foot, you will be on land I have given you. From the Negev wilderness in the south to the Lebanon mountains in the north, from the Euphrates rivers in the east to the Mediterranean Sea in the west, including all the land of the Hittites. No one will be able to stand against you as long as you live." How about a big amen there? "For I will be with you as I was with Moses. I will not fail you or abandon you." And he's talking to us right now when we decide to serve him. "Be strong," look at verse 6, "and courageous, for you are the one who will lead these people to possess all the land I swore to their ancestors I would give them. Be strong and very courageous." And he's telling them, "Be careful to obey all the instructions Moses gave you. Do not deviate from them, turning either to the right or to the left. Why? Because when you set your sights on Jesus, remember Peter, come walk on the water? He looked to the right, looked at the left. He seen the wind and the waves. He started to sink. But when he focused on Jesus, he was walking on the water. He's telling us right here, do not deviate from them, turning either to the right or the left of the instructions of the Lord. Then look what it says. Then you will be successful in everything you do. Study this book of instruction continually. Meditate on it day and night so that you will be sure to obey everything written in it. How do we be sure to obey what's in it? By studying the book of instruction continuously and meditating on it day and night. It's not rocket science how we get success here. Right? And then it says, so you will be sure to obey everything written in it. Only then will you prosper and succeed in all you do. Do you hear that, believer? Do you want to prosper and succeed in everything you do? Well, then you have to study the book continuously and meditate on it day and night. And then you will be prosperous and succeed in everything you do. The problem is we don't do that. And we want all that, but we don't want to do the work. We have to study it from Genesis to Revelation. And it has to be circulating in our minds day in and day out. And then we will succeed. Other than that, we're going to fail. He tells us the formula. He gives us the prescription. Whether we follow it or not, we can't just say, oh yeah, I love Jesus and everything's just going to fall into place and we're going to succeed in everything. No, there's things we have to do. Study the book continually. Meditate on it day and night so that you will be sure to obey it, everything you've written in it. Now look at verse 9. This is my command. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or discouraged. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. How about a big amen there? But you see the formula. Listen, this isn't osmosis. This is hard work. To put the flesh aside. Say, I'm going to put my flesh aside. And I'm going to get in that book and give God the best of me. I'm going to study the book. I'm going to pray that when I get in the Bible, he reveals himself to me. It is an act of your will. He will never invade your life without you asking. But when you do, he will reveal to you his character. He will reveal to you his blessings. He will reveal to you his power. The power is in the word. How about a big amen there? All right. Just getting warmed up here. Because, look, there's no greater power on the universe than in the word of God. Everything you need is in there. And he's already done everything for you. Do you realize he sees Jesus in all of us? All we have to do is tap into that power and use it? What is it? The spirit is willing, but the flesh is what? Weak. God wants the best of us, not the last of us. He wants you in the morning fresh when you get up. Let me get in the scripture now when I'm fresh. Let me have my cup of coffee. Let me hear what he has to say to me for today. Now I'm going to let that circulate in my mind for the day so I can be successful today. Get it? It's not like, oh, well, I'll pray later, but I want to be successful all day. But I'll leave God at home for now, and I'll get him when I need him later. Yeah, because when you run into problems is when you ask for them. He's like, ask for me before the problem so you don't get them. He's the problem solver. He's the way maker. All right. So we did all the fruits of the Spirit. But you know what? There was one that I felt that we have to talk about a little bit more. And that's self-control. The one everybody has struggles with. Who doesn't struggle with self-control here? Is it just me? We'll go in the back later and pray. No, we all struggle with self-control. We think self-control is willpower. Willpower is not self-control. Willpower is not doing something that you want. Self-control is God giving you the desire not to want it and to serve him. And giving you the power so you can do that. Because our flesh is strong when we want something. Can we all admit to that? We don't realize how strong our flesh is till we try to say no to it. I've heard more than one parent bemoan the choices that their children are making? What do you do when you can't stop the downward spiral of your health or their health, the finances, the country, or loved ones? Old Testament Daniel models a godly response. Daniel's world spun out of control when King Nebuchadnezzar destroyed his country and captured him and his three friends and hauled them off to Babylon. Remember the account? Daniel no doubt witnessed terrible atrocities, perhaps even the murder of his family. He was put into the king's service, indoctrinated in Babylonian values, history, language, and demonic religion. He was given a name that praised a pagan god. King Nebuchadnezzar possibly had these young men castrated. Talk about a world beyond your control. Yet Daniel not only survived, but he rose to the top and faithfully served God for over six decades under four pagan kings. His secret? Daniel practiced self-control in his private and public habits. Daniel practiced self-control in three crucial areas. With himself, he would not defile himself with food and drink. With others, he treated people with kindness despite his cruel environment. And in his spiritual habits and disciplines, he faithfully maintained spiritual disciplines for more than 60 years in captivity. Let's touch on a little bit of this morning. Go with me to Daniel chapter 6. The Bible is full of examples of how to do this. It takes a lot of self-control and discipline to stay healthy. It takes self-discipline to be able to say no to things that hurt us. It takes self-control to be kind to people that are unkind to us. Can I get an amen here? Yeah. And there's only one who can do that, and that's Jesus through us. Daniel chapter 6, look at verse 10. This is Daniel's routine that he did. Verse 10. But when Daniel learned that the law had been signed, the law was that if anybody had worshipped any other gods, that they were to die. He heard about it, and then what did he do? He went home and he knelt down as usual in his upstairs room with his windows open toward Jerusalem. He prayed three times a day, just as he had always done, giving thanks to his God. No matter what was going on, he developed that spiritual discipline to pray three times a day, just as he always done, even though that the king had said, if you pray to any other God but me, you're going to die. He did it anyway. Why? Because he had the self-discipline and self-control to keep doing it. Go with me to Daniel chapter 1. Now they're in Daniel. Even though he was in a pagan nation that was serving pagan food and doing pagan things, he remembered what God had told him to do and what not to eat and what to eat. Look at verse 8 of Daniel chapter 1. But Daniel was determined not to defile himself by eating the food and wine given to them by the king. He asked the chief of staff for permission not to eat these unacceptable foods. Now, God had given the chief of staff both respect and affection for Daniel. See, God went into him, the chief, so we put favor on him. Look at this. But he responded, I am afraid of my lord the king, who has ordered that you eat this food and wine. If you become pale and thin compared to the other youths your age, I am afraid the king will have me beheaded. Daniel spoke with the attendant who had been appointed by the chief of staff to look after Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Please test us for 10 days on a diet of vegetables and water, Daniel said. at the end of the 10 days, see how we look compared to the other young men who are eating the king's food, and then make your decision in the light of what you see. The attendant agreed to Daniel's suggestion and tested them for 10 days. Now let me reiterate what he did here, what he actually did. Not only was Daniel determined to not defile himself, but he was also kind to that guy, knowing that he could lose his head. See what he said here? Daniel made up his mind, determined, resolved not to defile himself after losing so much. Would you care whether the food served to you met your dietary standards? Eating from the king's table might be the only small compensation he'd receive. But that's not how Daniel saw it. His diet was part of his Jewish identity. It set him apart as God's child. His body belonged to God. He couldn't control the king and what others did, but he could practice self-control. Can I get an amen here? Now, for the sake of time, I'm just going to read this. Proverbs 25, verse 28 tells us, a person without self-control is like a city with broken down walls. Self-control is the fruit of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit provides the strength to control ourselves, even when everything else seems out of control. Self-control isn't gutting out self-will. It's submitting to the Holy Spirit and surrendering to His control. In Ephesians 1, 19 to 20, Paul prays that we will understand the incredible greatness of God's power for us who believe in Him. Now listen. In Ephesians 1, verse 19, I also pray that you will understand the incredible greatness of God's power for us who believe in Him. This is the same mighty power that raised Christ from the dead and seated Him in the place of honor at God's right hand in the heavenly realms. Do you realize you have resurrection power? You have so much power. It's amazing how much power you have. You have more self-control than anyone else that doesn't have Jesus. Trust me. You have it. The Spirit also produces kindness, though. Listen to what I'm saying here. Even in a cruel environment, Daniel treated others with kindness. When the officer offered him expressed concern that he might lose his own life, he let the Hebrew youth eat a different diet. Daniel proposed a test that took into consideration the officer's legitimate concerns. Because he said in Daniel 1, verse 12, please test us for 10 days on a diet of vegetables and water. Daniel said, at the end of the 10 days, see how we look compared to the other young men who are eating the king's food. Then make your decision in the light of what you see. The attendant agreed to Daniel's suggestion and tested them for 10 days. So he had compassion on the man, saying, look, just test us. If it doesn't work out, then we'll do what you say, because I don't want you to get your head cut off. You see? He was still kind to him. Can I get a big amen here? Listen, I'm trying to help you here. All right, we're going to have to close, but I want you to go with me to Romans 6, chapter 12. I mean, Romans chapter 6, verse 12. I'm not going to keep you all day, but I want to. I'll do you some good. Give you some discipline to stay in church longer than you should, than more than an hour. Just remember one thing. You're the church. You leave here carrying this church. You represent the Way Ministries when you walk out them doors. That's why it's important to absorb what you're thinking and what we're teaching, so you can apply it when you're out there and represent the ministry and Jesus properly. In Romans chapter 6, verse 12, it says something here. Listen what it says. Do not let sin control the way you live. Do not give in to sinful desires. Do not let any part of your body become an instrument of evil to serve sin. Instead, remove it. Give yourselves completely to God. For you were dead, but now you have a new life. So use your whole body as an instrument to do what is right for the glory of God. Sin is no longer your master. For you no longer live under the requirements of the law. Listen what you live under. Instead, you live under the freedom of God's grace. God's grace is the power to overcome sin, not to stay in it. What do you think God... Everybody twist that scripture. Listen, God's grace is the power to say no to sin, not a license to sin. God's grace is the power not to. Why do I say that? Because it says it right here. It tells us right here, you no longer live under the requirements of the law. You live under the freedom of God's grace, the freedom to do God's will. Well then, listen, here's a rhetorical question. Here's the humanism in us. Well then, since God's grace has set us free from the law, does that mean we can go on sinning? Of course not. Don't you realize that you become a slave to whatever you choose to obey? You could be a slave to sin, which leads to death, or you can choose to obey God, which leads to righteous living. How about a big amen there? And I close with this. At the end of the 10 days, in Daniel 1:15, Daniel and his three friends looked healthier and better nourished than the young men who had been eating the food assigned to the king. How about a big amen there? He kept the dietary requirements of his king. How about a big amen there? Thank you very much. All right, we're going to have to close there. I'm going to call the ushers to take up the collection. Thank you for letting me share that with you. Remember, we are sharing in the fellowship room. Come share yourself with us and have a donut. Brittany's going to come up and sing, and we are going to close. Let's stand.
Break the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain, high in the mountain.
Thank you, Brother Wayne. You want to come up and close us?
Let's bow our heads in prayer. Lord, thank you for giving us this beautiful church we call the Way Ministries. Lord, thank you for giving us a pastor who puts his ministry first, his brothers and sisters first, and always puts himself last. We're truly blessed to have him in our lives, Lord. My brothers and sisters, the Bible from Genesis to Revelations is the owner's manual to our lives. Lord, thank you for shedding your blood on the cross and freeing us all from that evil sin. And when we leave here today, my brothers and sisters, remember we have a choice to do what is right and not what is wrong. Yes, go in Lord. Peace, my brothers and sisters, and I say all these things in your holy, precious name. Amen.
Amen. All right. Thanks, brother. All right, the service is over. Come share a fellowship room with us. And we're going to say happy birthday to Brittany. Where is she? Hey, where is she back there? We didn't forget you. All right, the service is over. Till we meet again. God bless. Peace. Shalom.